Thanks for the introduction. My name is Martin Rosner. Together with my colleague Michael Sturm, we are the magnetometry development subgroup of the Fehlinger Group at the University in Munich. We started development of magnetometry and magnetic sensors due to the need for our experiment. So our chairs more a particle or a fundamental physics chair. And our main experiment is a search for the neutron electric dipole moment. And our sensor was developed especially for this experiment. That's I want to give you first a very short introduction to the experiment. Many people already know it. So the principle is always the same, like in nearly all NEDM experiments. You have two chambers where you put in some ultra-cold polarized neutrons, usually from just an ordinary high-flux nuclear reactor. And you have in both chambers the same magnetic field, so it feels the same, but in the chambers a different electric field. And our experiment is actually in France at the ILL. Was moved there from our own reactor in Munich, but just to political reasons and not scientific reasons. So, and as you have the polarized neutrons in your chamber, they will start to process around the magnetic field, and if you have some sort of electric dipole moment also around the electric field. And if you now compare the precession frequency of both chambers, the precession frequency will just be directly linked to this surged neutron electric dipole moment. Well, this is of course only true if you have really exactly the same magnetic field condition in both chambers, because if you have a different magnetic field, you will also get a different precession frequency. And there are a lot of problems, like if you have a field gradient, and in the last talk, of course, also your neutrons get a geometric phase if you have gradients. So all these field effects, or like high voltage breakdowns, all these field effects will also lead to a false NEDM signal. So you have to monitor your magnetic field very precisely and very carefully to say if it's a real NEDM or is it just some measurement artifact due to the magnetic field. So, and well, why have we started to develop our own sensor? So the decision was that we want a completely non-magnetic sensor, which means it should not produce any magnetic fields, which means this commercially available sensors already ruled out because they have all metallic parts. And we also want a purely optical approach, so with Bell-Bloom scheme instead of this MX-MZ scheme. So this alone, so completely non-magnetic, rules out, like I said, the commercially available sensors, and that's why we opt for our own development. We also want room temperature, so no heating or cooling of any kind, which means, again because we don't want any currents. You could, of course, heat also with laser light, but any temperature gradients would also lead to magnetic gradients to the material properties around the sensor. So we use anti-relaxation coated cells and no buffer gas cells. And the focus of our sensor is also different. And for example, for biomagnetism, you use a very high sensitivity. You need have a single event you want to see. But in our case, one Ramsey cycle takes about maybe 4 or 5 minutes. So you want to measure your field over this 4 or 5 minutes. So our focus is more on a long time stability, so low drift magnetometer, and less on getting the best sensitivity. Anyway, since you have room temperature, you will never reach the surf regime. And since it has to be non-magnetic, there are a lot of limitations. So it's obvious that you will never reach a really high sensitivity. But it's not so problematic because you need anyway rather stability than sensitivity. So the sensor was mainly developed by my colleague. And it looks like this. It's not beautiful, but it works. It is a 3D printed holder. And here we have this small anti-relaxation coated cesium cell. We have two incoming fibers, so polarizing fibers, just one for pump beam, which just goes through the cell. And you have one probe beam going through the cell, then a Wollaston polarizer, and then through large core fibers back to your electronics. So it's completely non-magnetic. There's no metal inside besides cesium. And yeah, all light, no coils, no metal. So yeah, that's the sensor, quite easy. So let's come to more interesting part, maybe some numbers and results. So nearly all of the following measurements were done at the PTB in Berlin, because they have at the BMSR2 a very nice, very excellent magnetic environment. This is a rather old picture where you see your coils, where you produce your fields. Then here is just the sensor. You can just place it everywhere because it's a fiberized sensor. And yeah, like I said, it's an older picture. You see, we had still the option to use also the squid for comparison. And yeah, we have also a free space setup. I want to focus on the fiberized sensor. And in principle, you could use orientation or alignment pumping. I will say something about this later. So let's start maybe as a first guess for sensitivity. What you can do is, in this optical pump magnetometer, you can just modify or change your pumping frequency. And if your pumping light pulse frequency and correlates to the precession frequency, you will get some sort of resonance signal here. So absorptive and dispersive, this is just from a lock-in amplifier. And then you can calculate some sensitivity. For example, if you say, okay, your measured field is around your zero crossing point here, then the zero crossing point will fluctuate with your noise. And then with ENBB and so on, you can calculate that for such a 30-second measurement, you will get reach a sensitivity of about 30 femtotesla, or if you like it more in a density, it's about 180 femtotesla per square root hertz, which is, like I said, not the best sensitivity we get, or one can get. But what you could change from linear polarization to circular polarization. And then you can get about a factor 4 in sensitivity. In theory, practice, it's less than factor 4. But if you use circular polarized light, you would also polarize your cesium, and a polarized cesium would have a magnetic field. So that's why we don't use circular polarized light. We have to use linear polarization. So that's one of the options. And also, with linear polarized light, you get only light shifts and higher tensor shifts, while with circular polarized light, you have a lot of light shift effects, which is, again, not so important if you're only looking for sensitivity. But since we're looking for stability, long-term stability, it's very important to have less light shift, because otherwise we had to stabilize the power. So and you could also heat up the cell, because when you get orders of higher optical density, you will also get a higher sensitivity. But like I said, all these options are just ruled out by our limitations. So we have to stick to room temperature and linear polarization. That's what we get with this type of measurement. Well, what we would do in the experiment is we would just pump the cesium and then look at the decaying signal. It's this pre-precession decay to avoid the free induction decay work. So what is there you can get with this free precession decay mode, you get about 5 to 10 data points or magnetic field points per second. And if you look at the L elevation, also measured in Berlin, we'll see that our drift at about 10 minutes is less than 100 femtotesla. So this L elevation, I think you're familiar with this, is just not showing sensitivity, so that it's showing stability. You can see even after 10 minutes, the stability is less than 100 femtotesla. So the minimum of our stability, or the best stability, is maybe about 6-8 minutes, and it's maybe 80-70 femtotesla. Of course, the exact numbers are always different from measurement to measurement, but it's always about 80-90 femtotesla at 5-6-7 minutes. And yeah, the Ramsey cycle is exactly here around this time scale. So stability is good enough for your experiment. Well, you maybe noticed this bump here, and then this more or less bump here. We were not so sure about what happens here, but we did a measurement of the external field around your chamber, and we could see that we actually saw in the external field surrounding the chamber that we also see up these two peaks in the external field. So this is not especially good example because this peak is just a bit shifted, but it's not the same day when it was measured, so this peak is moves a bit around. While we are not sure what these peaks are, because so PTB is in the city of Berlin, so it could be from subway to anything, we are quite sure that these bumps here are not from our system, but just the external field bumps here. So, yeah, just to prove that this was not just a one-time single shot, we reproduced this less than 100 femtotesla after several minutes, several times over several months also. As you can see, of course, the exact values differ from measurement to measurement. Sometimes the field is a bit more stable. Sometimes it's our measurement is limited by the field, or sometimes something goes really wrong, like here. That's usually just to the field stability or some 50 hertz noise which you get. But the sensor itself really always achieves about a stability of about 100 femtotesla below at several minutes. So, as I said, we have all the different operation modes. And the nice thing is we don't have to change anything at the sensor for this operation mode. So this means we can measure in free precession decay, let's say 1 minute, and afterwards in 1 minute free this force oscillation mode with a single sensor at the same position, and then compare directly both operation modes. So this is average to get the same sampling rate. As you can see, both sensors see both operation modes see the same field. Not sure if this was done before. But we see some static offset between these two operation modes, which is not so bad for us because in the experiment we would only use FPD mode and not this FO mode. And also we won't only track field changes and not the absolute field, but still there's some offset, maybe related to light shifts, but not sure about that. Yeah, maybe if someone have an idea why we have offset between these two operation modes. Yeah, you can contact us, or me. So you can also compare not only different operation modes with one sensor, you can also use three sensors. And as you can see again, all sensors see the same field here. You have the same jumps. So, and what you also can see, since the sensors are handmade, that one sensor here had a quite bad performance, and this sensor had a quite good, and there's something between. So it's still a bit problematic because it's handmade. However, if you look at the Earth field, so this does not mean the Earth field is dead, it just means no data. And here you have in the Earth field some jumps, and here this wobbling, you can also see it in your sensor. So we also, again, quite sure that, yeah, this systematics here are not our sensor, some systematics of our system, through really again, just the external field. So, since we are quite, it's a sensor doing what it should do. We are planning our next steps now, which would be, of course, in our experiment, we have to reproduce this gradient, and you cannot measure a gradient with only one sensor. So we have to scale up from one sensor to a sensor array, and the minimum number would be about 8. So if you have here your chamber, you can place 4 sensors around your chamber, and then in 3D it's 8 sensors. Of course, there are a lot of questions like laser power. You need more laser power if you had more sensors, and also how to get that all sensors have the same performance, the same transmission, the same temperature, and all these things. So it's still a bit to do from one sensor to a sensor sensor array, and also how to really do this 3D field reconstruction, dipole tracking, and also the optimal placement. So, some open questions. Also, what you may notice is here this sensor inside the high voltage chamber. The idea is here to place a sensor inside the vacuum chamber, inside the high voltage electrode. And since it's high voltage, you have to use free space approach. And the idea would that free space probing goes through the cell. This cell is actually borrowed by a Butka group to us, so it's still living, still working, still existing. And then it gets reflected and back through the cell to our measurement or electronics. And yeah, so since it's free space, is of course much less stable than the fiberized approach, but due to high voltage, we have no other chance. And it was demonstrated that we get the same or even better sensitivity, because we have a larger cell and so on, but the stability has still to be proven, that the stability is also sufficient and not only the sensitivity. And yeah, it's a double pass concept here. So why is it so nice to have a sensor in the center? Only very short. If you place your sensors around your chamber, you will see the lowest sensitivity is just in the center of the high voltage electrode. So it's quite obvious it's good to have a sensor here at the blind spot, more or less. So my last slide. Next idea was to produce a sensor to next generation sensor with a double pass to get better sensitivity, maybe a larger cell. Also reconstruction of the holder, get more stability. And yeah, applications were not really done by our group so far because we are only two PhD students, so manpower is very limited. So we're more or less busy with sensor development and applications. Yeah, maybe one of you want to use a sensor, you can have it. So yeah, thanks for attention. We have the optical non-magnetic sensor design, limiting our sensitivity by the drift of less than 100 femtotesla at 10 minutes. Thanks.